Good. Hello, you multi-method champenois chums, and welcome to... Oh, crap.
It's not crap at all, Roddy. Could introduce Roddy. Roddy is a special guest, a guest presenter here on Whisky Review number 400. And the reason is very simple, because I know, merry maltsters, just how much you enjoy these kind of round figure vlogs. You expect them to be something a little bit different, something a little bit special. And do you know what? For Whisky Review 400, we're not going to disappoint you, because we're reviewing champagne. Now, there's something you need to know. I don't like champagne. And there's no point in me introducing champagne and recommending champagnes when I'm not particularly sympathetic. I think it's overrated, I think it's overpriced, and I think it's a little bit of a waste of money which could be better spent on whiskey. However, that's just my personal prejudice. Fortunately, I know Roddy. We've gone back a few years, haven't we? Our paths have crossed a few times. And
Whisky Club.
Absolutely. And Roddy is, apart from having spent many years in the wines and spirits retail business, he's also a bit of a connoisseur on champagne. He knows a lot about it. So the remainder of this vlog, merry maltsters, is going to be Roddy's champagne masterclass. Everything from buying champagne to preparing it to opening the bottle to pouring the glass and anything else you need to know. Roddy, over to you.
Thanks, Ralphie. Okay, so we're going to start straight away by opening a bottle of champagne so that we can actually taste some of this lovely liquid. So these bottles have been very well chilled. Champagne, you can chill longer than other white wines because you want it to be a bit colder, so it's okay to leave champagne overnight in the fridge because it will warm up once you've taken it out. Now, you saw there that I don't have a cloth or anything. I was just being careful to keep my hand near to the cork, so that as long as you've got the champagne well chilled, the cork's not going to shoot out, and then you just grab the bottom of the bottle and twist. And the French like to say that when the cork pops, it should sigh like a contented woman rather than popping like a contented man. That's the French for you. There we are. Just a wee hiss there.
How very French.
Very French indeed. So this first champagne that we're tasting is Palmer & Company non-vintage.
Now, while Roddy's pouring that, you'll notice that he very carefully and sympathetically opened the bottle. He did not pop the cork and send it flying towards the ceiling. It's just something I'd like to add, which I find absolutely hilarious, is that if you're ever watching Grand Prix racing or motorcycle racing in the television, at the end of the race, when the winners are on the podium, they get the bottle of champagne, they shake it violently, they whip off the cork, and then they spray it everywhere. Certainly, as a motorcycle fan myself, I noticed the TT, they spray it over each other, and then they empty the remainder over the heads of the Boy Scouts, who are forming the Guard of Honour. Now, the reason for that is simple. It was an early publicity stunt for champagne, because it basically it's showing, if you're a winner, you can simulate masturbation. Shaking the bottle, flying the cork off, and then scooshing all the contents around the people around you. So there's subliminal psychology involved in that, saying that basically with champagne on the podium, if you're the winner, if you get first, second or third place, you get to whack off using a bottle of champagne. Now, back to the more serious stuff.
Well, of course, that's just a waste of one of the best wines in the world, Ralphie. Champagne is expensive. Champagne's probably more expensive than any other wine. This first champagne that we're tasting just now, it's what you would call an entry-level champagne. It's the standard bottle, and it still costs around £27. And that's the kind of money that you're talking about for champagne. And that's because champagne's got such a glamour about it. It's the wine of kings.
And this specifically is Palmer & Company Brut Reserve. There we go.
This is a great champagne. It's an entry-level champagne, but it's a really good one. And it's not one that's so easy to find. The company's a growers cooperative. So the name's not famous, because unlike the big houses like Moët Chandon or Bollinger, they don't spend money on advertising. They don't sponsor Grand Prix. Mm-hmm. They don't give bottles away to be wasted. So all that £27 that you're spending on this goes into the actual quality of the wine. Now, what do you think of it, Ralphie, as a non-champagne drinker?
I find it... It's clearly good quality stuff, but I find it slightly astringent and rice winey. That kind of vinegar note that you get comes naturally with many white wines. I'm not a huge white wine fan, really. This is good stuff. I'll have another wee taste. And
it is tart, but that's part, for me, of what makes champagne so great. Because when you make champagne, it's a complicated process. You make wine, as you would any normal wine, but then there's a secondary fermentation in the bottle, which is where the bubbles come from. After you've made wine, you add some more yeast, and then it re-ferments, just like a bottle-conditioned beer. And then you have to get the yeast out in a beer. You would leave that in, and you would have cloudy beer. But champagne has to be clear and sparkling. So they take out that yeast, and then they top up that little space in the bottle, and they use grape sugar. So they sweeten the wine slightly. The base wine, therefore, for champagne has to be tart. So there's this great balance in champagne, which you don't get in sparkling wine anywhere else in the world, between a base wine, which is really quite tart. Like, if you drank still wine from champagne, it would be far too tart. Even if you were a white wine drinker, you wouldn't like it. But because they've topped it up with a little bit of sugar, then you've got this, just, it's balanced, it's poised. You know, it's always threatening to go off to be too tart or a little bit sweet, but it just sits there. And I think that's what I love about champagne, that it's got balance in a way that no other sparkling wine has. And I would love it if it was cheaper, but, you know, you pay the money because you can't get this anywhere else in the world. This is, as I was saying, Palmer, they're not a big house. They're a growers cooperative, they were formed just after the war, and the story is that the name that they had was hopelessly unmarketable. So they were casting about for a name for the company, and apparently with rationing just after the war, in Champagne, a packet of Huntley and Palmer biscuits cost more than a bottle of champagne and was more highly sought after.
Right, that's so very interesting.
So they decided that if they used the name Palmer, then people would want to buy their champagne. So it's actually named after biscuits. But
that's a brilliant story. I love that. Now, the other bottle you have here, if I could ask you to open that one,
okay,
please. So it basically, it's now an opportunity. If whatever you're drinking, when you come to it, if you drink it in isolation, you have a restricted point of reference. You're relying on your own memory of different flavors over the years that you've built up in your inside your brain to give you a sort of your bearings. However, you can really help yourself by having something for direct comparison, because it's a very useful point of reference. Hence the reason, well, it's just the pitiful excuse we're giving for opening another bottle of champagne here.
Two bottles, hurrah!
Roddy's really quite pleased about this review, because I'm not going to drink much of it, so he basically gets the two bottles.
It's a hard life. Somebody's got to do it.
Gently does it now.
Yep, once again.
This is the posh stuff.
Twisting the bottle so that...
So are you withdrawing the cork, the bottle from the cork, rather than...
No, all I'm doing is twisting the cork. The pressure pushes the cork out as you twist it.
Right.
You don't need to pull at all. You just twist the bottle and the cork itself gently eases out. So this should be very quiet. See, that was just a little, tiny little poop.
Quite an aggressive sigh, that one, but it was still
sigh. I wasn't as careful as I was with the Palmer. So this second champagne is Laurent Perrier Grand Siècle. So as Ralphie said, we're into the good stuff now. This is what's called a deluxe cuvee. All the big champagne houses these days make a deluxe cuvee, by which we mean that they select the very best of all of the grapes that they've got, and then from them the very best wines that they make, and they set them aside to be a higher quality cuvee. And the deluxe cuvées are generally aged for much longer than standard champagnes, so they've got a lot richer flavours that come with age.
Certainly, and I immediately notice that there is a kind of extra slight dry syrup note to this. And again, as is the French sensibility, is that the oak is very restrained. They don't kind of, they're not flooding it, just kind of oak flavouring. It really is quite balanced.
Well, that's actually, with this wine, it's rather than oak, it's oxidative ageing. Most champagne houses don't use oak at all.
Oh, right.
There's very few that do, because we saw it with the first wine. There's crispness to it, and there's a real tartness, to be honest, as well. But, you know, if you like champagne, you like that tartness. What you're seeing in the second champagne is that because the wine's aged for much longer, this first champagne, the Palmer, that's going to be about 3 years old. Whereas the Laurent Perrier Grand Siècle, the wines in this are likely to, some of the wines are likely to be 10 years old.
I tell you, it's a good thing you're here, by the way, Roddy, because I was convinced that that the maturation of champagne began actually in oak casks and then was transferred for further maturation in the bottle. But it really is, it's 100% conditioned, shall we say, in bottle.
Yeah, I mean, the champagne starts in a steel tank, apart from a few houses. Like, for example, Bollinger, they'll use a fraction of wood. Krug, another...
A fraction of wood?
Like, some of the champagne will be in wood casks and the rest of it will be in...
So it does happen?
Yeah, right, yeah, okay. But it mostly doesn't. And then the wine gets put into bottle and the second fermentation happens. And that's, I guess, for most champagnes, that's where the important flavours happen. Because both of these champagnes, and sorry, Ralph, I know you can only pick up one glass at a time, but if you go from one to the other, oh, a man of many talents. If you go from one to the other, they both have a toastiness to them, and that toastiness comes from the second fermentation in the bottle.
Right.
It's not from wood contact.
Right.
The bottle fermentation is the most important part.
So can you give three tips, Roddy, for people looking to buy a bottle of champagne? Three practical tips.
Right. First of all, I'd say if you like the big name champagnes, then watch out for them going on promotion, because the big houses like Moët or Veuve or Tattinger, they spend heavily. That's why their champagnes are expensive, but they spend a lot of money on promotion, so grab them while they're a tenner off at the supermarket.
You see the same thing with whisky, of course, the Chivas Regal and Johnny Walker.
Yeah.
An awful lot of big money. I mean, the one comment I heard was up to 25% of the cost of a bottle of notable blended whisky is marketing, which is a huge margin.
The Veuve Clicquot, you know, they sponsor the racing at Ascot and the Open and things like that. So, you know, you can imagine the sort of money that they're spending.
Millions.
Yeah. So that's tip number one. If you're buying the big brands, and the big brands are good, they're big because they're quality products. If you're buying them, buy them on deal, because otherwise you're kind of paying for the marketing. But I would also say seek out smaller brands, and for that you kind of need to go to independent wine merchants, because the smaller brands, they don't have marketing budgets, so all of their money goes into the wine, and very often the smaller brands, they're likely to be just a single vineyard, This doesn't usually happen in Champagne, but you do get some single vineyard wines, mm-hmm. and there the flavours are, I think, more interesting. Mm-hmm. And then the third tip I would say is that rather than buying a big brand champagne in a non-vintage, mm-hmm. spend the same money and buy a non-big brand champagne, but the vintage, because the step up in quality, mm-hmm. when you go from non-vintage to vintage champagne is really big. Because champagne is a bit different from the rest of the wine world, nearly all of the products are non-vintage. So because of that difference, champagne makers, they kind of put a lot of effort into vintage champagne, even though it's not very important to the market. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like if you buy sherry, mm-hmm. you know, which is a great bargain. In the same way, if you're buying vintage champagne, relative to the high base that the price starts from, but relative to that high initial cost, vintage champagne is actually a bit of a bargain.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much, Roddy. I really appreciate this. You've been far more constructive and sympathetic and, you know, objective than I would ever be. Because, as I say, I'm really, of all the alcoholic beverages out there, champagne is not something that I gravitate to at all. But we're just going to wind up the review now, just to let you know, if you're interested in buying champagne, if you happen to be in Glasgow, we are actually in the tasting room at the Good Spirits Company in Bass Street in Glasgow. Yes, if you're not sure where the shop is, you can easily find it. A wee Google search or Yahoo search or whatever search engine you're using, you'll have no problem finding it. And just one more thing to conclude our review. Could you hold the microphone, please? Thank you very much.
No!
Tiny drop.
Sacrilege.
Right, smell that and taste that. Smell it and taste it, and then tell me I'm not wrong.
Actually, it's two of my favourite things. That works, Ralphie. That works. Oh man, that works.
We didn't rehearse this.
No, champagne and smoky whiskey. That's today's top tip, viewers.
There we go.
That works.
Thanks for watching, Malt Mates. We'll be back shortly with Whiskey Review 401. It won't be that far away. These vloggy reviews and that whiskey stuff, well, it never is that far away at Ralphie.com. Thanks for joining us. A thank you to Roddy, our champagne expert. Thanks, Roddy.
Thank you, Ralphie.
And we'll see you soon. Bye-bye now.